Remember the fireworks we looked at earlier? We were trying to figure out how those fireworks got their colors. Now we're going to see that fireworks get their colors because of the movement of a single electron. In order to understand this, we have to know the properties of electrons, their locations, and how they move. So let's rejoin our students to see how they're doing with these topics.
Remember J.J. Thomson and his model of the atom? He's credited with the discovery of the electron. An electron is a tiny, tiny particle with a negative charge that's found outside the nucleus of an atom. Electrons are really important to properties of the elements and the bonding, but we'll cover that in a future unit. Let's look at the Bohr models of several elements. Please have your periodic table nearby. Remember, Bohr's the guy who has determined the energy levels of the atoms. I created a Bohr model of lithium and beryllium using these model kits, but I could have drawn them too, like you see on the monitor. First, look at your periodic table. What patterns do you see between the location on the periodic table and the models of these different atoms? Talk to each other about what you see.
Lithium, beryllium, and fluorine all have two energy levels and are on the second row of the periodic table. Is a row a periodic or a group?
I think the rows are also called periods. Sodium has three energy levels and is on the third row.
Yeah, but sodium and lithium have one outside electron and they're in the same column.
They're both in the first column, and beryllium has two outside electrons and is in the second column.
So what did you guys notice about the periodic table and the Bohr models?
Well, lithium and sodium both have one electron on the outside energy level.
Did you notice anything else about lithium and sodium?
I was going to say they're both in the same column.
Yeah, they're both in the same column, column one. And they both only have one electron on the outside, but beryllium has two electrons on the outside, and it's in column two.
Good job of linking the periodic table to the Bohr models, Kat. The outermost electrons are known as the valence electrons. Does the valence electron pattern hold for fluorine?
Well, fluorine has seven valence electrons and is in group 17, so the pattern doesn't work for everything.
But group 17 can also be known as 7A. If you consider that, does your pattern work?
Yes, it does. If you ignore the 10 transition metals, then group 17 makes sense as 7.
What other patterns did you guys notice?
I see that beryllium, fluorine, and lithium only have two energy levels and they're in row 2.
So what's the pattern?
Well, the row number is the same as the number of energy levels.
Very good. Use your model kits to create a Bohr model of neon, and you guys use your kits to create a model of fluorine. Start by looking at your periodic table to determine the number of protons there, and that will be the same as the number of electrons. Now that you have your models built, how many electrons does neon need?
Neon has 10 electrons because its atomic number is 10.
And how many of those electrons go in the first energy level of neon?
Only two of those electrons are in the first energy level.
How many electrons will go in the first energy level of fluorine?
Fluorine also has two electrons in the first energy level.
What about the second energy level?
Fluorine has 9 electrons and 2 go on the first energy level, and the 7 left over go on the second energy level.
Okay, what about neon's second energy level?
Neon has 8 electrons left for the second energy level.
Perfect. Remember, fluorine is in group 17, or 7A, and has 7 valence electrons. Neon is in group 18, or 8A, and has 8 valence electrons. And of course, when you don't have model kits like these, it's really helpful to still draw the models out. Do you guys remember that fluorine is a halogen, and halogens are very reactive? Neon is next to fluorine, and is a noble gas, and not reactive at all. Look at these Bohr models for fluorine and neon. What differences do you see?
Fluorine and neon have the same number of energy levels, and they both have 2 electrons in the first energy level.
But we're looking for differences. Fluorine has 7 valence electrons, and neon has 8.
Why do you think that difference makes neon non-reactive, but fluorine very reactive?
Wait, I have a question. What if fluorine got one more electron? Would it be non-reactive?
Good question. No, it wouldn't. Well, let's talk about why. What else would change about fluorine if it got another electron?
Fluorine would get another proton too.
Actually, and this is very, very, very important, atoms can gain and lose electrons, but not protons. If fluorine got another proton, it wouldn't be fluorine anymore.
Aren't protons positive and electrons negative? If fluorine got another electron and it would have more negatives, can it do that?
Another good question, and yes, it can. This Bohr model of fluorine that I added the electron to, it would now have a negative charge and it would be called an anion. atoms are generally neutral, but sometimes an atom can gain an electron and become a negative ion. Some atoms can lose an electron and become a positive ion. An ion is an atom with a positive or negative charge. Positive ions are called cations. You can remember they're positive because the T in cat looks like a plus sign. The negative charged ions are called anions. Ions have different properties than their neutral atom, like how easily they react with other chemicals or how easily they dissolve. Fluoride is still reactive once it becomes an anion.
Why would fluorine do that? Is it better to be neutral?
Let's look back at our Bohr model to answer your question. Now, how are these two models alike?
They both have 8 electrons in the outermost energy level.
Yes, they do. 8 electrons in that energy level is a full valence shell, which is very stable. This is why neon atoms are non-reactive. Noble gases all have full valence shells. Non-noble gases can gain or lose electrons to have full valence shells because it's more stable.
But why would atoms lose or gain electrons?
Atoms that don't have a full valence shell are reactive, which means they're likely to change by gaining or losing electrons or by bonding with other atoms. Only atoms that have a full valence shell are stable and not likely to change. Let's take a look at magnesium to see an example of this change. How many valence electrons do you see for magnesium?
2 valence electrons, because it's in group 2.
And what would have to happen for it to have a full valence shell?
It would need 6 more electrons.
Or lose 2.
Okay, nature takes the easiest, lowest energy path. So which of those options do you think is more likely?
It would be easier to lose 2 electrons than gain 6.
Okay, so what would the charge be?
It would be positive.
That's right, but how much positive if 2 electrons are removed?
It would have 2 extra positives.
So would that make it a cation or an anion?
It would be a cation since it's a positive charge.
Nice work.
Electrons can do more than move into and out of an atom. The movement that creates ions is not what gives fireworks their color. Electrons aren't stuck in a specific energy level, and they're not orbiting around the nucleus like planets orbit the sun. Electrons are usually found in their lowest energy state, which is called the ground state. Remember what our students learned. Nature takes the lowest energy path, which is why electrons are normally in their ground state. But electrons can gain and give off specific amounts of energy. And if electrons give enough energy, they can move to a higher energy level called an excited state. These units of energy are called quanta, the singular form of which is quantum. A quantum is a specific amount of energy that can be absorbed by an electron as it moves from ground state to excited state, or released by an electron as it falls from the excited state back to ground state. When electrons absorb a quantum of energy, they can make what's called a quantum leap to an excited state, where they're farther away from the nucleus. Then the electrons can give off that same amount of energy as they fall back down to the ground state, closer to the nucleus where they're more stable. When we light fireworks, we're adding energy to the fireworks. Some of that energy causes the electrons to jump to an excited state. Higher energy states are not very stable, so the electrons fall back to the ground state, giving off the quantum of energy as the colored light we see. Each element gives off a different range of colors because each element has a different number of electrons. Calculations can be performed to determine the amount of energy and the type of light that's given off. If you'd like more help with this, check out our Closer Look video, Calculating Light and Waves. We can observe the different colors of light that are given off through a flame test, where you put various metal salts into a flame and observe the different colors of light. In a flame test, what you're actually observing is the electron falling from the excited state to the ground state. And these different colors of light are what we see when we're watching fireworks. So let's get back to our classroom to see how our students do with their flame tests.
We've talked a lot about electrons, and this flame test lab is a great way to see the effects of electrons moving amongst different energy levels. It'll be kind of like our own, much quieter, fireworks display. So look at the lab supplies at your table. You have cotton swabs, some distilled water, and spot plates with different ionic salts in them. Most of these samples use nitrate as the anion. What are some of the cations you see?
Copper.
Lithium.
Sodium.
Potassium.
Good. What type of elements are all of these different cations?
They're all metals.
Exactly. All of your samples have different metal ions. What you're going to do with each sample is dip the cotton swab in the distilled water, shake it off a little, and then dip the end into the salt sample you're testing. You only need a little bit of the sample. If you have too much in the cotton swab, it might fall into the burner, and that kind of junks up the burner. Hold the salt against the side of the flame and watch what happens. Why do you think we're dipping the cotton swabs in water?
Okay. So the salt will stick to it?
Does it keep the cotton swab from burning?
Both of you are right. If you leave the cotton swab in the flame too long, or if you stick it too far in the flame, it will burn, and it will affect the color of the flame. Before you try your first sample, do a control test of the wet cotton swab. Leave it in the flame until it starts to burn so you can see what color the flame is. Do not turn it into a mini tiki torch. Do not turn any of these into tiki torches. Once the sample is tested, place the hot cotton swab on the table to cool before you throw it away. Make sure you record your observations for each sample. You're recording qualitative data, so be very descriptive. Red might not be descriptive enough. What if there's more than one red-colored flame? You're going to use your data to help you identify these unknowns later. Okay, give it a try, be safe, and I'll be right here if you have any questions.
Cool, a red flame.
I think it's more like hot pink. I'll write it down as magenta. Do you think that'll be specific enough?
I think so. I hope so. Now let's try copper.
Wow, that's bright green. I wonder if it's always the same color. Let's do it again.
Why would it change colors if the electrons are excited to the same energy levels and then fall back? Shouldn't it be the same color because it's the same energy?
That makes sense, but let's try it again to make sure. Cool, still green.
I think the sodium is a yellow-orange color. Or do you think that's the cotton swab?
I think it's more yellow than the cotton swabs. Let's record it as yellow and gold.
Okay, let's try potassium.
That looks like lavender, but the color disappeared so quickly.
I saw lavender too.
Now that you've collected your data, I want you to use it to identify these two different unknowns. Make sure you record your observations of the unknowns, too. Mia, will you get the gas for me? So this is unknown number one.
A red flame, but it was purplish red. I think it's lithium.
I'd call that magenta, but I think it's lithium also.
There's too much pinkishness for it to be strontium, which was the only other red sample we saw.
Okay, here's unknown number two. Will you turn the flame off for me? And what do you guys think?
Copper is in that sample. I saw the bright green flame, but I also saw red.
Me too. Can there be a mixture of unknowns?
What does your evidence indicate?
I think this is a mixture of copper, for sure, and strontium, I think.
I think so too. I saw the red and green, but the red wasn't a purpley red like the lithium sample.
Copper and strontium. Are we right?
You're not going to tell us, are you?
No, I'm not. Does your evidence support your conclusion? Did you collect your data properly?
Yes and yes.
Can you think of any reasons why your data might be flawed?
I wonder about the mixture. In art, we talked about how some colors cancel each other out. What if the green or the red canceled something else out? Or what if we saw was a combination of two different salts and we missed them both?
Those are some great points. And that is a flaw in using this type of test to identify mixed samples. Now I have a question for you. Why did you see these colors? Why wasn't copper purple instead of green?
Well, different colors of light have different amounts of energy.
And Bohr's research said that each energy level in each different element has a different amount of energy.
So the colors have to do with energy differences of the different energy levels in atoms.
When the electrons get excited by the flame, they jump up energy levels, and when they fall back to the ground state, the energy is given off.
So that's why copper is green. It's the energy of the electron moving energy levels, and that's why copper is always green, because that electron moves between the same levels.
Great answers. If we took the light from our flame test and directed it through a prism, we get a spectrum of lines that can correspond to that specific element. When we think of light going through a prism, we also often think of a rainbow of color being produced. But that's not what we see from the colored light of a flame test. This is called a spectroscope, and it provides a way to see the spectrum of a chemical. We use it to look at an element, such as the mercury in the sealed tube. Look through it. What do you see?
I just see a bunch of lines that are different colors.
Me too.
Now look at this sample. This is neon.
Still lines, but not the same lines as with mercury.
Each element produces a characteristic pattern of lines in its spectrum. The lines correspond to certain wavelengths of light, and therefore certain amounts of energy. As the electron moved from one energy level to another in each of the samples, the spectroscope separates those wavelengths from each other and gives us a fingerprint of sorts for each of the elements. These are spectra for three of the different flame test elements you tested: beryllium, copper, and strontium. You can see how the spectra are different for each. Using the identified samples, can you identify the unknown?
That's easy, it's strontium.
Right, strontium and the unknown each have the same spectral lines. Good job.
So we've learned a lot about electrons in this lesson. The periods, or rows, of the periodic table correspond to the number of energy levels in an atom. The family, or column, corresponds to the number of valence electrons. Electrons can be added to atoms to make anions, or removed to make cations. And we learned that with enough energy, electrons can move energy levels within an atom and give us this. Great work. There's even more information waiting for you on the periodic table. Join us for the next video in the playlist. We'll learn even more about the periodic table when we study periodic trends.